What's good, y'all? We are back with another reaction video today. Today we have the real reason why Tua struggled in his rookie year. This conversation comes up a lot in the Twitch chat with, you know, the Dolphins fans and stuff like that. Because I say I wasn't really sold on Tua this year. Kind of like the, you know, all the other rookie quarterbacks, if I'm being honest. Their performance. Now, I'm not going to say he's trash or anything like that. Because, I mean, like, coming into the season, I actually wanted to see him play a little bit. I thought the safe thing was to keep Fitzpatrick as a starter. But I like what I saw, you know, in Bama. And I like, you know what I'm saying? I liked him as a quarterback. But then when he started playing, it was just like, it seemed like the defense carried. It seemed like the offensive play calling really wasn't even all that. Maybe the O-line was the issue a little bit. I don't know. But we'll see. We'll see what this video says. This is by AlexRollinsNFL. Makes some really good football content, man. Really good content. So shout out to him. Check this out, man. Hey, I'll say this, just like I said with I said this about Drew Lock as well. Tua has all the weapons he needs right now. Drew, I said this about Drew in a different video, but with them adling Will Fuller, I mean, he may not have that number one dominant receiver like a Julio Jones type level, but he does have, you know, he got Devontae Parker, he has Mike Gesicki, underrated tight end. If y'all don't, Mike Gesicki is very nice. Jakeen Grant. What's my guy name? Preston Williams. Obviously Devontae. If I say him already, Will Fuller. He got a nice receiving core. It's not a lot of huge names, but they're nice. Jalen Waddle. The other receiver who they got from the Raiders, I can't think of his name. He played quarterback at Kentucky, but he nice though. Like, they got a very versatile set of offensive weapons, so it's there. I don't know how good the O-line is, and that's a huge factor. I don't know how good the O-line is, but as far as weapons go, I like his weapons a lot.
Fifth overall pick in 2020, nobody anticipated Tua time winding down before it really had a chance to get started. To begin his career, Tua sat behind Ryan Fitzpatrick the first 6 weeks of the season, but after the bye week in week 7, to the surprise of everybody, Brian Flores and the Dolphins announced Tua would be the starter. Although he went 7-3 in those 10 games, his arrival kicked off a turbulent stretch for the Dolphins offense where Flores benched him multiple times during games due to his poor performance. And even though they finished 10-6, the Dolphins missed out in the playoffs in the final
game nice
after
pick.
Getting blown out by the Bills. While there were some impressive highs, there were even lower lows, raising questions and concerns about Tua's viability to play quarterback at a high level. All of the abilities that led to him being drafted 5th overall were actually areas he struggled in during his rookie season. His accuracy diminished and was unpredictable, his pocket movement was rushed and unsettled, and his ability to anticipate throws and manipulate defenders almost completely disappeared. But, at the same time, it wasn't all on Tua. There's plenty of blame that goes to the Dolphins' lack of an overall plan and structural issues on the offense from top to bottom.
Yeah, like I said, I feel like their play calling was a little bit stale at sometimes. Like, sometimes throughout the season, it was really nice. And then, I say closer to the beginning, maybe. It was nice, especially when they got, I can't think of his name. Like I said, the dude from the Dolphins, from the Raiders, who played quarterback. But when they got him, they started switching it up a little bit more. But, yeah, they could have been better on offense than what they play calling.
Signed a few months before the Dolphins drafted him, they first brought Chan Gailey out of a 4-year retirement to become their offensive coordinator. But that wasn't a move made looking into the future, but a move made more focused on the present. Gailey was brought in because of Fitzpatrick, who he'd coached not just once before, but twice. And he installed an offense around Fitz, whose play style is the polar opposite of Tua's. Fitz is a gunslinging, push the ball into a tight window, throw a jump ball down the field type of QB, and Gailey designed the system around him and not Tua at all. One of the scheme's core aspects was aggressive throws to one-on-one isolated receivers, which was a perfect fit for Miami's receiving corps since they had massive receivers like Devontae Parker, Preston Williams, and Mike Gesicki. The system and personnel were designed for the offense to win one-on-one matchups instead of being centered around timing-based concepts that stretch out the defense. The scheme didn't fit Tua, and the personnel didn't fit Tua. And if you're wondering what changed when he became the starter, the answer is just about nothing. Gailey's usage of 3x1 alert-style concepts is a perfect example of this problem. These concepts required Tua to frequently throw deep one-on-one isolation routes, which aren't geared towards his strengths or what he excelled at while playing in college. This type of play design has an alert side and a concept side, where Tua determines pre-snap, or sometimes post-snap, if this alert route will be one-on-one. That could mean it's just man coverage, or if he sees safeties rotating away from that side of the field. And if he didn't have that one-on-one matchup, he'd go right to the concept side. In his second start, he had some success with these alert concepts, and he led the Dolphins to a 34-31 win, which would end up being his best game all season. But after his brightest hour, that's when things began to change.
It's funny though, like how he said, the personnel didn't fit Tua. I feel like if you got weapons, you got weapons. And I understand that, you know, his play style is more like drive the ball down the field versus Fitzpatrick gunslinger. So I'd assume, you know, with Tua, he probably want a lot more possession catch receivers versus speed receivers. And I mean, even though they got some big body receivers, oh man, I feel like it was kind of the play calling, like, and like he said, the scheme was set up for Fitzpatrick, not for Tua. But I don't know, I just think they could have just got a little bit more creative, switched it up. I'm not a coach, so I wouldn't be able to say, you know, specifically what, but it's just when you watch one team doing something and then you see this team doing what they're doing, it's just like, why they not doing that? You know what I mean? Like, it's this stuff is working versus, you know, I don't know. I just think they could have switched it up just a little bit.
2 weeks later against the Broncos, he completed just 55% of his passes for just 83 yards and was benched in the fourth quarter.
Sheesh.
When the Broncos used a second safety to take away his alert route.
It looked like he could work on his deep ball accuracy a little bit.
His numbers really began to fall off a cliff. On the season, he rarely pushed the ball more than 20 yards downfield, and when he did, he had just 8.9 yards per attempt, which was 29th in the league, and a 76 passer rating, which was 25th. He struggled when he was under pressure with just 4.7 yards per attempt, and that was often due to his reluctance to sit in the pocket and progress through concepts, since he would instead get fidgety and scramble. Here's the 3x1 formation with Devontae Parker outside as the alert, and then a dagger concept down below. The Chargers are playing cover one robber, which was a common coverage against the Dolphins since teams often tried to double, trap, rob Mike Gesicki in any way possible, especially on third down. So cuz Tua sees a safety rotating down away from his alert, he correctly starts with Parker, who had trouble winning on these outbreaking routes all year. But here's the issue with Tua and why there's major cause for concern moving forward. Instead of progressing backside to the dagger route that's moving into the space created by Gesicki running the cross and Tua's eyes moving the deep safety over the top of Parker, Tua doesn't settle in the pocket and scan the field, but instead tries to scramble to create a second play.
I mean, he got pressure though.
And Tua's eyes moving the deep safety over the top of Parker, Tua doesn't set.
Yeah, he got pressure. There was nobody open right here at all. I'm not gonna lie. The buddy down here, he didn't finish his route. So if he would have been right here, if he would have been at least facing here, maybe it's the timing, maybe. But covered. Now, if he would have been at least facing this way, that would have been a completed pass for sure. But from the whole way, you got pressure.
The cross and Tua's eyes moving the deep safety over the top of Parker, Tua doesn't settle in the pocket and scan the field, but instead tries to scramble to create a second play. He's not Lamar Jackson or Josh Allen, who will consistently create with their legs. But that's the kind of quarterback he tried to be in his rookie season, instead of staying true to his own skill set. Yes, Jerry Tillery destroys Jesse Davis off the ball, but Tua needs to step up into the pocket to evade Tillery while keeping his eyes downfield to see the dagger route come open. But after he comes off the alert, his next move isn't to reset like he needs to, but to run. And if he could...
I'm not gonna lie. Just my opinion. I feel like even if he stepped up right here, he already beat completely. Like, if he stepped up right here, he probably would have got a holding call because he's beat.
He comes off the alert. His next move.
Even if he stepped up right here, he's beat. He's completely facing this way. Like that. Yeah.
Isn't to reset like he needs to, but to run. And if he continues to do that, he's simply not going to last very long at all. He'll have to continue developing.
Oh, low-key, a nice throw. Just the accuracy wasn't there. But that was actually kind of nice.
Being into a rhythm-based pocket passer with great vision, quick processing.
And that's what I'm saying on a lot of these throws, bro. There, the accuracy ain't all the way. Accuracy not all the way there.
Anticipation, because he doesn't have that athleticism or high-end arm strength like some of the other NFL quarterbacks do. Here's a concept that's schemed up to take advantage of the coverage the Chiefs are playing, but requires that patience and progression ability inside the pocket that Tua showed in college, but not in his rookie season. The Chiefs are playing Tampa 2 zone with two deep defenders and a middle run-through linebacker, and the Dolphins concept has Gesicki on this middle read route, plus they have a backside crosser from Devontae Parker. When Tua sees the safety sprinting back at the snap, he should anticipate the 2-high structure and Gesicki to be open. But since it's Tampa 2, the linebacker matches Gesicki's route and the safety squeeze in on him as well. Backside in breaking routes are really good against Tampa 2 since that linebacker is running up the field with his back turned. So Parker has nobody anywhere near him, but Tua never sees him. No matter what kind of progression is installed on this play, Tua has to find an open receiver here. If Gailey wants him to read Gesicki, to curl, to flat, Tua has the flat receiver open. Or if it's designed to come back to Parker when Tua sees the run-through backer out of the picture, well, that would have worked too. The Dolphins' offensive line had plenty of issues of its own, and that's really a whole nother story. But here Tua has a clean pocket and 4.5 seconds to work with, plus he looks right at Parker breaking into his vision, but instead moves up in the pocket for no reason and takes a sack, making it...
It's that pressure getting in there. It's probably what's messing with him, bro. Probably the pressure, you know, because at Bama, I'm pretty sure maybe he had more of a stable offensive line. Not saying the Bama linemen were better than these, obviously. But just on that level, when he was playing there, he probably wasn't getting pressured as much. Because he looked real like, you know, like he just looks ready to move.
But like, instead moves up in the pocket to work with. Plus, he looks right at Parker breaking into his vision. But instead moves up in the pocket for no reason and takes a sack, making it third and long. Discomfort in a clean pocket is something we see all the time with rookies. So it's not like this is something crazy. But since poise in the pocket was one of Tua's perceived strengths coming out, well, it's something he'll have to clean up fast. These issues in the pocket reared their ugly head, especially on third down, when he couldn't use play action, RPOs, or the threat of his backs running, and his numbers absolutely plummeted. On first and second down, his QB rating hovered in the 90s, but on third down dropped all the way to 64.
Sheesh.
His yards per attempt fell 2 yards, and his sacks and interceptions shot up. The Bengals are showing an all-out cover zero blitz with no safeties deep, and they're not even trying to disguise their intentions. They're bringing the house. They have 7 up on the line to outnumber the Dolphins 6 in protection, and have man-on-man coverage for each of the receivers. Tua has to be prepared for a free runner since the Bengals are showing an extra guy up front. So he needs to determine who his hot receiver is, meaning a quick route he can hit if that extra unblocked pass rusher actually comes. He has 2 potential blocks and a slightly longer developing corner route to Gesicki's tight end, and a faster quick out to Jakeem Grant up top. So it's not necessarily wrong to choose Gesicki, but Tua fails to use anticipation and timing and waits an extra half sec to get the ball out and gets pummeled. Right when his back foot hits, the ball needs to come out now, but Gesicki still has an extra step before he gets out of his break, so Tua hitches instead of anticipating him coming.
They're gonna have to work on their timing.
These extra little hitches popped up way too much in the film, and are often the difference between a successful play and a disaster. With all the obvious frustration you could see in Tua, Brian Flores, and the Dolphins' offense as the season progressed, there were some glimmers of hope that showed why he was drafted 5th overall. There are serious questions about his arm strength, but then he'll make a throw or two like this one every game, even though it was dropped, where you can see legit ability. The Dolphins are again running their dagger concept, where Tua will read the deep cross from Devontae Parker first, and then if he's not open, hit Jakeem Grant on the dagger route. The Chiefs are playing cover one man match, where it's man coverage, but when Parker runs the crosser, Tyrann Mathieu takes him, and Bashaud Breeland replaces his zone in the middle. Despite the corner's inside leverage on Grant, Tua is able to use his eyes to move Breeland a little too far towards Parker, then come back and squeeze in a pass that should have been caught. You can see him look at Mathieu, then come back to read Parker on the cross, and even though there's again a little tiny hitch, he throws a missile to Grant with pressure closing in. Plays like these are impressive and do inspire that hope, but the bad is far outweighed by the good and has cast a cloud over this offense heading into 2021. The good news is the Dolphins added Jaylen Waddle and Will Fuller, who aren't the big body isolation types, but more fit the yards after the catch style that Tua excels with, and the Dolphins have hired two new offensive coordinators, yes, two, which is kinda odd, but two offensive coordinators who will build an offense purely around Tua and nobody else. This was a Ryan Fitzpatrick-based offense schemed up for deep shot plays and an isolation style that didn't fit Tua at all, and there were hardly any changes when he took over. Tua needs a system built around the quick to intermediate game, timing-based progression concepts, and rhythm-based throws that can turn into big yards after the catch opportunities. And if the new Dolphins coordinators can build that system for him, we will see vast improvement next season. But it's extremely concerning that so few of his talents translated even in a non-conducive offensive scheme, and Tua needs to take a long, hard look in the mirror and realize how he can readjust and redefine who he is moving forward. If he can play from the pocket and not outside of it, play in rhythm and hit his receivers with timing.
I know I'm late on this, but I wonder how they're going to make the two offensive coordinators work. Because, you know, two people calling plays. Maybe they working together, because two heads think better than one. Maybe they working together to come up with a diverse amount of plays for him. But it's going to get weird when it comes down to play calling.
Master the mental game and have a plan for each and every progression on each and every play, create and execute yards after the catch opportunities, and help build an offense that can lay this foundation and begin to grow, then Tua time has only just begun.
Man, good video again. Good video again.
Yeah, I don't know.
We just gonna have to see how it play out. I mean, from what I see in this video, it's he was praised for his poise in the pocket in college. And like I said, I would assume that's because the stability of the O-line a little bit more so than him. You know what I'm saying? Just him getting the ball out quick. Because if he was that get the ball out quick type of quarterback, he'd be throwing a lot of interceptions. So he's not. So he's still trying to make plays. I think the O-line, it looked from this video, it looked like the O-line was an issue. And not only that, play calling a little bit, but it's just it seemed like they worked with Fitzpatrick more, and they made sure he was comfortable. More than they focused on making sure Tua was comfortable, because they didn't intend on starting Tua week one. So that's understandable, because they didn't intend on starting him week one. But I'm like, if you're going to go with that decision, then stick with that decision. But hey, I think the fact that they did play him gives them an idea of what to look for this year now. You know, I got them a little head start on this year. So, I mean, it was kind of bad, but then it's good at the same time, because – you know, y'all got a idea of what y'all need to do so y'all can get to it ready. And I think it's going to work out, man. That division is tough, bro. It's a tough division. All three, them, Pats, and Bills, I can see making playoffs. So, I don't know. I really have no idea what to expect completely, but they're all, like, playoff potential teams. So, we're going to see what happens. Let me know what y'all thoughts are, you know. Drop a comment below. Appreciate y'all for watching. Like, subscribe, stay tuned. Stay blessed.
You done messed up, A.A. Ron!
Yeah. Hey, Hall. Man.
man amongst boys. I walk with the Lord, gotta be careful what you say, because your tongue is a sword. Why you speaking what I'm thinking? Ain't no